Father, this morning we ask that you would just fill us with your joy. Lord, there's an elusive excitement going on. I don't know where it's coming from. But Lord, I do know that you are here and that you're moving, you're among us, and that you're doing great things among us, things that we may not even see at times. Lord, we surrender to your will today. We ask that we would walk away different people for being assembled. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, well, we live in the strong and unshakable kingdom of God. So y'all sing out today with us. Here we go.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless and awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Thank you.
Have a seat. The first month of the Jewish calendar is called Nisan. It is a month that begins in our calendar year somewhere around March 20th. It is the first month of their calendar year because of what God did with them. It's the time when God delivered them from Egypt. And you know the story, right? You know of God moving in and the 10 plagues and the final one being the plague of the firstborn. But God stepping in and taking care of his people. He told them on the 10th day of that month to take a lamb into their house, care for it, and then on the 14th day to slaughter that lamb, put some of the blood on the top of the door and on the side of the frame. And that evening when the angel of God would come through the land, every door that had the blood of the lamb on that door, the angel would pass over that house. There would be no death there. This occurred, and there was a great mourning in Egypt, and Israel was set free. On that same 14th day of the month, God instituted for all time for the people of Israel to celebrate that Passover meal. That every year they would gather together and they would retell this story, and they would slaughter a lamb and eat of that lamb and tell of God's faithfulness. And that day started another festival that ran along the same time frame. It was the Festival of Unleavened Bread. See, in that meal, they ate bread that didn't have yeast in it because they were in a hurry and they didn't have time for it to rise. And on the 14th day, they were to go into their house and remove all of the yeast from their house and keep it out for a week. And for that week, from day 14 to day 21, they would eat bread without yeast. And they did this every year as well. This removal of yeast as a symbol of removing sin from their home. It was God's design that on this day, the Lamb of God would die. See, it is around the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread that Jesus is offered as our sacrifice. And it is in that meal that he turns and he takes of the bread and points to the cup, calling it his blood and saying, "This is about me." As God has delivered the people of God in the past, I am now delivering you. There will be no more death in your house. Sin will be removed. Freedom and status as the people and children of God are now yours. Father, we ask for you to remind us and renew us in the power and strength of the resurrection of your Son. Thank you for his blood. Thank you for our freedom. It's in Jesus we pray. Amen. It's these things that we celebrate when we move into communion. We eat of unleavened bread. We drink of the cup, claiming Jesus' promises. Eat and drink with the Lord, and let's celebrate what he's done. The table set in the front and the back. Come to the table and let's worship.
May fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul
thank you.
through shadows. I'm not giving up. Where you go, I go. If you stay, I'm not moving. Through the valleys, the shadows.
Are we not blessed? Amen. Yeah, you guys do such a wonderful job. I don't think we thank them nearly enough. Bridge, y'all are free to head on back, fifth and sixth graders. All right, so this goes out to the guys, but there's probably some girls that would do much better with it. What? Do what, buddy? I would love for you to say that. He has something he'd like to tell us real quick.
So one Sunday, me and my mom and my grandma went to Family Worship Center and I got baptized.
I'm sitting down now. That's beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. That's awesome. Wow. Baseball. Who likes the game of baseball? Yeah. Y'all been watching a lot of baseball? I don't watch it nearly as much as I'd like to. But one of the things about baseball is, I don't know if you've thought about this, but offensively, you don't touch the ball. It's one of the only sports where defensively that they control the ball the whole time. So there's not much that you can do as an offensive player except bat. One of the greatest plays of all time that came out was a sacrifice bunt. Who knows what a sacrifice bunt is? It's absolutely cool. This morning I looked at the definition of it, and it says a sacrifice bunt occurs when a player is successful in his attempt to advance a runner or multiple runners at least one base with a bunt. In this vein, the batter can sacrifice himself, giving up an out in order to move another runner closer to scoring. It's one of the greatest plays of all time where you get to sacrifice yourself with a bunt so that you can advance others so that they can get closer to scoring. This morning, as we are going to pray over our offering, I want you to think about that analogy right there, that sometimes we've got to sacrifice ourselves in order to advance other people, other runners, so that they can score. So I just thought that was, with during baseball season and all of that, I was thinking to myself, how can you relate that into giving? And sometimes we've got to sacrifice ourselves in order to advance the kingdom so that God can be known. True? Let's pray over our offering. Father God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for that young man that wanted to boldly say that he was baptized. And Father, I thank you for that. I thank you for that vision of what that means to not only each and every one of us, but to his future. So Lord, we pray over him. Lord, we pray over our offering, our giving this morning. And Lord, there's multiple ways that we can give, but sacrifice is really where it's all about, where we sacrifice ourselves for others. And one of those ways that we can do that is with our monies, so that Lord, you can use that money. You don't need it, but you use that money to advance your kingdom for others. We say thank you for that. We love you. Thank you for sticking these little things in our minds that remind us of what it means to give and to sacrifice. For it's in your son's precious name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen.
I say God is good. You say all the time, God is good. All the time. Sometimes we just need to hear that. It's a moment of joy and celebration that we're moving into. And as we do, this is part of the celebration for me is this is week two for me to be back, and I'm excited to be back with you. As we celebrate that God is good, regardless, I have a question for you. When you think of the phrase all in, what do you think of? You think of Texas Hold'em and getting your chips and pushing them all the way into the table and hoping that the person on the other side like panics and they just give up, right? What do you think of when you think of the phrase all in? I asked some friends this week and here's what they said. Totally committed. No holding back. With everything you've got. CS Athletics. Kind of like that one. No plan B. Heard the phrase burning the bridge? Like you've crossed it. We're burning that. We have to move forward. I saw this phrase about this online and I thought it was worth sharing with you. Be all in or get all out. There's no halfway. As we jump in this morning, I want to invite you to consider what would it mean for you to truly be all in with Jesus? Like that bridge is burnt. There's never a moment where we're going back. There is no plan B. For us to come to the place where we say we are all in, because there is no halfway. We're moving through the Gospel of Mark in our Jesus Followers series, and our series has brought us to Mark chapter 14. And this specific story gives us a beautiful illustration of what this is, what it means to either go all in or all out, because there is no halfway. Let's just listen to it for a moment. Mark chapter 14, we'll start in verse 1. By the way, we're going to be hanging out here all morning. And so if you want, this scripture will eventually go away. If you want to follow along and look at some things as we teach through, in the Bibles in your chairs, it's on page 710. Or you can use your phones. Verse 1. Now the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread were only 2 days away, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were scheming to arrest Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the festival, they said, or the people may riot. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume. made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her harshly. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want. But you will not always have me." She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priest to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted to hear this and promised to give him money. So he watched for an opportunity to hand him over. As we jump in, I want to tell you this story is most likely familiar to you. All of the Gospels that we have in our New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, have an anointing story of Jesus. Three of them tell a very similar story, and they shape it according to what they want you to know. Luke tells a completely different scenario. It's often the one that we hang on to about a sinful or an adulterous woman, and there's so many different things going on in that story. But Matthew, Mark, and John tell this story. I'm not going to approach this story in view of all of their three accounts because I think Mark has something very specific for us. Mark tells us what he wants us to know and, quite honestly, doesn't tell us things on purpose for where he wants us to go. When we get into this story, I read this week, and as I was jumping in, I came to it with questions. And I think that's how we're going to walk through things today and just ask some questions of Jesus, ask some questions of the text, and see what it is that Mark has for us today. And so here we go. The story begins in verses 1 and 2, outside of that home of Simon the leper. It begins telling us some context, and it's the chief priests and the teachers of the law want to arrest and kill Jesus. Like, what? Why did they? I think it's significant for us to ask this question. Why did they want Jesus dead? We're in Mark chapter 14. There's only two chapters left in the book, and it is rapidly moving toward the end. And this issue started at the very beginning. The conflict with Jesus and the teachers of the law and the chief priests started at the very beginning of his work. You find Jesus in Mark chapter 1 doing some healings that the teachers of the law couldn't explain. And by chapter 3, it goes sideways really quick. And I'll show you that in a second. In between, in chapter 2, Jesus starts not only healing, but healing on the Sabbath, the holy day when you're not supposed to work. And Jesus is doing some work, at least that's how it was interpreted. Not only was he healing on the Sabbath, he allowed his followers to pick some grains in the field, and in conflict with the teachers of the law came because Jesus wasn't observing the law, at least as they read it. You get to Mark chapter 3, and Jesus is in a house. He's teaching, and these teachers come to him to take charge of him. In other words, they're going to try to shut him up or arrest him. And they actually use the language that Jesus is possessed by Beelzebub. The language of this word actually means, I had no idea about this, it's something that I've missed over the years. Beelzebub means the Lord of the Flies. I was actually in that play when I was in high school. And if you know anything about that play, like the Lord of the Flies, it is humanity going sideways. I got to play Roger, who was the guy that killed Piggy. The Lord of the Flies is a metaphor that actually is pointing to the Lord of the dung pile, because it is at the dung pile that the flies come and hang out on, and it is a slang to refer to Satan. In chapter 3 of Mark, the teachers of the law are saying that Jesus is possessed by Satan. The conflict has been growing for quite some time. He also is seen not observing their teachings of ceremonial washings before they ate. The teachers of the law saw Jesus as a threat, and they saw Jesus not teaching as they taught and not interpreting the law as they did, and it threatened their teaching, their authority, their power with the people. And they didn't know what to do with the unexplainable power of God that he used. It had to come from evil because they didn't have that. Chapter 8, we find that they try to trap him. And then we get to chapter 11. We're getting really close to chapter 14 in our text. We get to chapter 11, and you have the triumphal entry of Jesus, right? Remember when he's riding on the colt, and the people are laying palm branches down, and they're shouting and singing praises to God, and they're saying Hosanna, which means save. God saves, right? Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Like, the one that we're expecting is here, and Jesus has shown up at Jerusalem, and there's this huge celebration. Well, they were gathered there in preparation for their celebration, for the Passover feast. In the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the multitude had entered Jerusalem. And the very next day, Jesus' response is to throw gasoline on this conflict situation. He goes into the temple, and it's where he makes his whip, and he turns the tables over, and he challenges the misuse of not only the teaching, but the misuse of the actual worship of God, challenging the authority of the teachers of the law. And then in verse 12, Jesus is playing Texas Hold'em, or chapter 12, he's playing Texas Hold'em, and he pushes his chips all in with these religious leaders. And standing in the temple courts with all of the multitude of people around, Jesus turns and he says this, watch out for the teachers of the law. They liked to walk around with flowing robes. They liked to be treated with great respect in the marketplaces. They liked to be given the places of honor at the banquets. And yet they devour widows' houses. They steal money, basically, from the poor and those who can't care for themselves. They make a lengthy show of prayers just to be heard. And they will be punished greatly for these things. Jesus initiates the conflict. It's time. And those who have twisted what it means to be in relationship with God need to be called out. And he needs to be exalted. He's preparing for his death. Why did they want to kill him? They had no other choice than to get rid of him. So the next question is like really simply folded into it. It's like why did they fear a riot with the people? Well, imagine this. He has just entered with that triumphal entry. The whole multitude, thousands and thousands of people are celebrating him, right? If they now arrest him and take him in, they fear those crowds turning on them. And couple that with the moment in time that this is. The festival of the Passover, where the people of God, it's the most holy day for Israel, celebrating, remembering the story of the deliverance of God, for them to arrest and murder someone during this time, in the most holy of moments. Chief priests and teachers of the law, they're not stupid. They knew this would be a bad look for them. So number three, it brings us to the house. This woman who comes and makes such a grand gesture. Why would she do that? Now, please don't yell it out. How much money do you make a year? Most of us know. Can you do the math? Do you know what that paycheck looks like when you divide it up over 12 months? How much money do you make a month? How many days a week do you work? So how many days a month do you work? Can you do the math? Do you know what you make a day? It's a really interesting exercise for me to do this and actually put it in my phone and do the calculator. A denarii was a day's wage. The NIV says a year's wage in it, trying to help us understand, because 300 denarii doesn't mean anything for us. Imagine 300 times your day's wage. That's what this woman poured out on Jesus' head. Why would she make such a grand gesture? Mark intentionally doesn't name her. He intentionally doesn't give us her background and previous relationship with Jesus. He lets us know that they're in Bethany. But that's all we know for Mark. Could it be that this woman had come to understand the true identity of Jesus? Like that he's the Messiah. And it's worth acknowledging him is worth everything that I have. Undoubtedly, she is responding to some kind of personal interaction with Jesus that has changed and transformed her life, whether it be a miracle or a teaching or the love and grace from him relationally or all of the above. Something about Jesus has caused her to go all in for him. Which brings us to the meat of our story and the meat of our teaching of Jesus followers just like me. Who and why were the people in the house so indignant and harsh with this woman? Mark doesn't name them. But I want you to acknowledge the level of escalation that has occurred by the time we hit Mark chapter 14. The opponents of Jesus that we occasionally see eating dinner with him would not have been in that room in this moment. And we actually, in fact, see in Mark chapter 11, when Jesus goes into Jerusalem, it says, because it was late, he returned to Bethany, which was 2 miles away from Jerusalem. It would be like us walking to John Lilly's down the street. Take about 40 minutes to get to Bethany. Jesus had some friends there. It was like his hangout. It was his home base so that he could go sit it with his friends in a safe place and then go into Jerusalem, create all kinds of chaos, and then go back to Bethany and have dinner. Like, that's what's happening here. The people who were indignant and harsh with this woman were the disciples themselves. They were Jesus' closest. They were his friends. Why so harsh with her? I want to propose to you, they weren't upset that Jesus was being anointed. They were upset with the extravagance of it. Like any rational person, like if you're going to anoint Jesus, anoint Jesus. Go sell the rest so that like we can use all of this stuff for good. What's the most good that we can use with all of these thousands and thousands of dollars of worth of perfume? This woman didn't care about rationality at this point. She cared about honoring Jesus. And I want to propose to you that there's something in the disciples that was embarrassed, because they had not or could not make such a grand gesture. Jesus' response to this is, like, shut up. She did a beautiful thing. Mark wants us to make some connections. In Mark chapter 8, we saw that Peter acknowledged that Jesus is the Messiah. The word actually means the anointed one, the Christ, the coming king of God's kingdom, but the word is the anointed one. Jesus is being anointed the day before he's arrested and moved into the cross. The Messiah is being marked. And it's no small anointing. It is an anointing unlike any that they had ever seen. Extreme extravagance for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So much so that Jesus says, everywhere my name is preached, everywhere my message is preached, what she has just done will be declared to the world. See, for this woman, this story not only speaks to Jesus being the Messiah, but it speaks to a story of great devotion. A story of her personal great sacrifice. Speaks a story of her going all in on Jesus. And it leaves us with this. If she would go all in like that, why would Judas' response to this moment be to betray Jesus? Could it be that Judas wanted a different Messiah? Could it be that Judas wanted the political Messiah to overthrow Rome's government and let Israel stand? Could it be that Judas was always on the fence? He was always lukewarm. He was always trying to decide, am I in or am I out? I'm not sure. I've walked away from my life. I've given everything to Jesus, but sometimes he's crazy. He's doing things that I don't know yet. Could it be that he was so concerned with money that Jesus' praise of this kind of extravagance, instead of using it for people, instead of using it to do good, like Jesus is like, bring it on. Keep doing that. Like, I'm the man. Like, that's just too much for Judas. I want to propose to you that Mark doesn't connect the dots for us for a reason. He intentionally doesn't color in the lines so that we can relate as readers with simply his response of betrayal in this moment. You see, this story holds up the contrast between this woman who is all in with Jesus and Judas and makes a choice to be all out. So it brings us to the place where we need to ask our final questions. Questions for us, not just of the text. I've got three of them for you. And I want to ask the Spirit of God in this moment, Father, help us to hear what we need to hear. Help us to respond in the way we need to respond. So just like us, this may be inflammatory for you, and it's okay for me if it is. But what about Jesus offends you? Everyone in this story was offended, except Jesus and the woman. The chief priests, the teachers of the law, Judas, the disciples, everyone was offended, except Jesus and the woman. Let's be honest for a moment. There are things about Jesus that are hard for us. There are things he asks us to do that are difficult. There are things that we have to give up. There are words that we have to speak that are sacrificial. And so in view of the things in this story, let me ask you, do any of his teachings, when applied to your life, do they upset your sensibilities? Do you lose some of your rights when you say yes to Jesus? Do you lose some of your power or your status? Everyone in that room did. But the woman who gave it all and lost it all, we're still talking about her today. So will you trade Jesus away like Judas for momentary gain or pleasure? Will you betray him for these things? Or will you anoint him as Lord? As you consider anointing Jesus as Lord, I have another question for you, and it's this. What would it look like in your life? And for you, it will look different than me. But what would a grand gesture of going all in with Jesus as Lord look like in your life? What would it look like for you to value Jesus over everything else? Would it impact what you choose to do with your money? Would it be a monetary gift to him and his kingdom? Would it be a life-altering decision about your work? And I'm not necessarily saying changing what you do for a living. It might be, would it be a life-changing decision in how you approach your work? There was lots of offense in this story, and so let's ask that as well. Would it mean a decision to follow his way in response to people who have offended you? And I want to leave you with this, our last question. Jesus promised that everywhere the gospel was preached, that this story about this woman would be told. And so I want to ask you, is there someone in your life, who in your life has sacrificed so fully that you need to tell their story as you tell his? Who in your life has gone all in for Jesus to the point that it's caused impact on you? We need to acknowledge and celebrate that. And maybe let me just stick a thorn in your side that will stay there and fester for a week or two. if you're having trouble coming up with a name of someone who's gone all in for that's impacted you that way, just maybe that name needs to become you. What would it look like? How would it change your life for you to go all in on Jesus? Let's pray. Father, do your thing. We ask for one thing today, Father, and it is for Jesus to be Lord. You have made him Lord. You've declared it. It will be so, whether we acknowledge or not. And so, Father, we ask that in the power of your Spirit that we make him Lord and we celebrate with you. Have your way with us, God. It's in Jesus we pray. And the church said, amen. Y'all stand up with us. We're going to close in with one song in worship. And if there is anything that you need, we want to invite you to come and pray. It may be that today, in this day, you need to, for the very first time, declare Jesus as Lord. We'll receive you with that. It may be that it's time for you to redeclare that, for you not to straddle the fence, not to be all halfway in and halfway out, but for you to redeclare that it is, that bridge has been burned. It may be that you simply want to celebrate and praise our God together with someone else as we pray, as we worship and pray and thank him. Whatever it is that you need, come and join us as we worship.
Here's my heart.
It's worth doing again. God is good. All the time.
All the time.
God is good. He is. There are three things that I need to leave you with. And they're really good things. This afternoon, we are having our prayer meeting at 5 o'clock. That's one of the things that has been such a beautiful movement over this past year. We have just kind of wrapped up in our Transforming 500 Lives piece. We've just wrapped up a focus of spiritual formation, of pursuing God in practices of prayer and scripture. And it's beautiful watching this family prioritize prayer together. Come at 5 o'clock. Come join us with that. And speaking about that, next Sunday at 6 o'clock, the whole city is praying for our schools. And I want to encourage you to come join us with that. We always have a good showing at Journey. What if all of us just showed up for that for an hour? Like, we just overwhelmed the city with crazy Journey people that want to pray. Wouldn't that be awesome? Yeah. Let's mark your calendars this afternoon and then next Sunday at 6 at the schools. We'll start at the high school. Oh, it's 7. We can pray for an hour and then pray with them for an hour. 7 o'clock next week, 5 o'clock today. We prayed for and said goodbye to Lindsay last week. And Tanya King is standing in the gap right now. We want to thank her. Yeah. In between services next week, I want to invite you to join me in the JSM building for 10 minutes. We want to do an interest and information meeting about Journey Kids. Let you know where we are, what's happening, and where you can help and where we're headed. We're excited about what's coming and what this future is going to be, and we just need 10 minutes from you. So hang on next week. Go join us back there in the back for 10 minutes and hear all of that. Last thing, and then I'll bless you. I asked you to get your phones out last week and mark your calendars for August the 13th. Are y'all ready? Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. I got one woo from the back. So Holly Brenner, a.k.a. Holly Tucker, she got married 18 months ago, will be joining us August the 13th, so that's 2 Sundays from now. She is being presented as our candidate for our worship pastor position, and we could not be more excited to introduce her to you. We are just super... There you go. That's the response I was looking for. You guys show up in 2 weeks. Come just be ready for a beautiful, beautiful celebration. It'll be a great day to have her with us. As we go, in the name and authority and power of Jesus, may he be Lord for you. May we as a family go all in with him. And may life come as a result. Till next week, let's walk together and make a difference.
As I surrender, I can see.